I grew up in Muskegon, Michigan, and it's on the west coast of Michigan, right across from Milwaukee. Grew up in a big family, had five sisters and no brothers.
How did that affect you, having all those sisters?
Well, it could cause problems because I was the oldest. I was the oldest, and all the girls were younger than I was.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Oh, yes, yes. We had a big family, and during the Depression, we never had a car, to give you an example. At the age of 12, I went to work. I started out by delivering groceries, a nickel, a bag, in my bike, and then I graduated up to 10 cents an hour. And I did this for 6 years. I think I topped out at 20 cents an hour. And going to school at the same time, I'd get out of school, go to work at 4 in the afternoon, and get done at 10 at night. That's when you waited on the people. Now you go, you know what it is in the supermarket now. But you waited on the people, you doled them out 5 pounds of sugar or so. And for 6 years I did that and went to school at the same time. Not every night of the week, about 3 nights. And my partner was a lady, and we worked on Saturday. And of course I'm from an old Dutch family, which don't believe in working on Sundays. And so I approached my boss, and he never asked me to work on Sunday. Never asked me to work on a Sunday. I did a couple of times because of emergencies in his family.
Were you a kind of kid that liked school?
Oh yes, I was a type of kid that I was never late for any class. And two of my buddies knew this. So one day they unpurposely held me out of class at 1:15 in the afternoon, so Hartman couldn't go around and say that he hadn't been late for class. Now this was in high school. I think, I just didn't miss school. Just didn't miss school.
You know, you've described having to go to work. The Depression did have an impact on your family. You know, when you think back on that time, did you like your childhood?
Oh yes, we were provided adequately. We had maybe a main meal. It was two slices of bread, and mother always had canned tomatoes. That was a meal. I can remember as a kid, we used to eat, you won't believe this, mustard and sugar sandwiches. It was quite a feast, and I hate mustard today. But no, very good. It was tough. We had one good pair of shoes and another pair of shoes. In the summertime where we were at, we run around a lot barefoot. That's what we did. I went to a pattern making shop to try to get a job, try to learn the field of pattern making. And I talked with a gentleman and he said, George, I can start you out next week. It will be 40 cents an hour. And I says, what about the service? And he said, George, if your number comes up, you're going to the service. And as a young man, I thought, well, maybe I should try and make some money before I go. And so I went to work in a what they call a seal power that made aircraft rings and pistons and stuff like that. And I managed in that short time that I worked there, you can think of this, I managed to save $15, $25 war bonds, which we bought for $18.75, I guess. That's what I managed to save before I went in the service. That was my funds. And I did manage to find enough money to buy a little car, 37 Ford to be exact, with mechanical brakes that would freeze in the winter. So you had to be careful. Yeah.
Talk about enlisting and the training. Kind of take us through the process.
I was drafted in February of 43 with about 160 some of my classmates from our area. We went to Camp Grant at that time, and a couple of days we spent there for not interrogation, what is the word that I want to use, just to familiarize us with the service. I was on a shipping order with a lot of my friends, which I didn't know, went into the anti-aircraft to El Paso. When they called out all these names, I can remember, hey, save me a seat, save me a seat. When they got all done, the sergeant says, that's all. And just being a rookie, I walked over and I says, sir, what's the deal? I'm on that list. He says, you're the first supernumeral. If somebody would have been sick, you'd have went. So I ended up about 2 days later on an Air Corps shipment. I had always liked airplanes growing up. In them days, you could buy cheap balsa kits, and I loved to make airplanes.
Had you ever been on an airplane?
I don't recall ever being on an airplane at that time.
Did it seem kind of glamorous?
No, but I will tell you this, and I made a big mistake in my life. When I did get in the Air Corps, I don't know whether we went down to Florida. And what happened, they put us in what they call, we were going to the hotels. The government was, they had too many of us at time for, they didn't have the accommodations. And so in March of 43, they put us on a golf course in St. Petersburg that belonged to Jimmy Fox, the ball player. And it was all tents. And the first night we got there, they didn't have any cots, so they said, you'll have to sleep on cardboard. Well, the tail of a hurricane went through that night, and most of the tents were gone in the morning. So we didn't get any sleep. But that's where we got our briefing. You took your test, and this is what you qualify for. And the guy says, what do you want to be? And I said, I want to be a gunner. Little did I know that how my life would change after that. I wasn't a hero, don't get me wrong, but I just wanted to be a gunner, a 19-year-old kid, you know. And so he had said to me at the time, you qualify for radio school, you're from Michigan, they have a radio school in the Stevens Hotel in Chicago. So I signed up. When they finally condemned this camp, because half of our men were sick with dysentery, they condemned it. I had to stay behind and pull guard duty in KP. By the time I pulled that, the radio school in Chicago had closed. So they shipped us to Arizona to gunnery school. And we went to gunnery school out there in Arizona. Gunnery school was a new experience to me. We were in Kingman, Arizona, elevation of about 7,000 feet. And my first night I was there, during the night I woke up and something was running in my eyes. Unbeknownst to me, it was blood. And because we had came from Michigan, where our elevation is about 700 and some odd feet, and this was about 7,000, that's how it affected me. So,
were you bleeding from the nose or something?
Just bleeding from the nose that was running into my eyes. So I went to the flight surgeon, and they run me through a special test, run me up to 50,000 feet in the pressure test thing, and I passed it. And I never had trouble after that with that circumstance. It was just that first day of getting used to that altitude.
Did the gunnery school include training with like shotguns and things?
It started with BB guns, 22s, shotguns, 30 calibers and 50 calibers. In my family back home, my mother didn't believe in guns. So I had never shot a gun. And because of that, when we went out skeet shooting, the instructor got very uptight with me. because when we would follow through, you have to follow through and then pull the trigger. When I would follow through, I would stop and I'd pull the trigger down. And he said, Hartman, if you should shoot 15 feet above that bird, I'll give you a hit. And that was my experience on, and I did get better, don't get me wrong, but I had never shot a gun before in my life. Never shot a gun.
Well, take us through, you got your gunnery training. What happened after that?
From gunnery school, we never got to town because it was just a small little town of Kingman, Arizona. And they saved that for the personnel that lived there and worked there. So then they shipped us to radio school in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. About 60, 62 of us. We ended up going through Omaha, and from Omaha we went to, I went to radio school in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. I was with the 507th squadron.
Did you have to learn Morse code?
You had to learn the Morse code, and typical, when we first got there, you could pass with like 14 or 16 words a minute. Then they kept getting more men and more men, and to get the best men, they raised the code speed up to like 20, at least 20 words a minute that you had to pass to get out of there. I was there until January of 44. And then I got shipped to Florida.
So was the intent, you were going to be a radio man at that point?
I was starting radio. What happened to me, I washed out of radio school because of the code. There were two letters I'll never forget, N and U, that I had trouble with. Da, dit, dit, da. And I had trouble with that. And you were only allowed to make so many character mistakes in so many words or letters, and those two cost me. And so I actually ended up washing out of radio school after having all this training. From there they shipped me to Florida, the 3rd Air Force down in Tampa, Florida.
And so where did it go from there?
From Tampa, Florida, we were assigned our crews down there. We were based in a baseball field. The mess hall was underneath the grandstand. This is where we got our crews and all your tests for flying. You had certain, if you were colorblind, you washed out. They wouldn't accept you. Anything that wasn't right, they would wash you out there. Any person that passed all these tests would end up being assigned to a bomber crew. And that's, our officers were on one side of the field, the enlisted men were on the other side of the field. And that's where I was assigned to my crew.
Talk a little bit about the crew coming together and the phase training that you went through as a crew. What was that like?
Well, we were in Tampa, and the government gave me 7 days to go 10 days to go 7 miles. We went out to Drew Field, which is now Tampa International. I had a furlough, and so I called my girlfriend, and I had said, if I get another furlough, we're going to get married. I didn't want to go overseas and leave this lovely person with a child. But I got this 10 days, so I had called the minister, and we went home, and we were married on March the 9th. But I got in trouble by doing that, because when I came back late. I had to find a quarters for my wife. And so when I came back, I was called in to the commanding officer. I can remember the man. I can remember the man's name. And he said, how come you're late, soldier? And I said, well, I went home and I got married. He said, what did you say, sir? I said, sir, I went home and got married. He says, don't you know this is the most foolish thing you could have done? You're going overseas in 3 months and going to be in combat. But there I was, you know, a PFC. And so he restricted me to the base for 1 week and a week's KP. And my new bride was in a strange town, and she had never been out all by herself. That's my just the experience that happened to us when we first came there. Tampa was the 3rd Air Force, and we got about 3 months training down there, crew training. That's where we got our training.
Let me ask you about the crew training, because it's a collection of officers, enlisted men, guys from different parts of the country. How did everybody get along? Did they coalesce pretty well?
On our crew, very, very good, very good. The oldest man on our crew was a fellow by the name of Douglas Mahidi. He was from New York, and he was the oldest man on the crew. He was 28 years old. He had had some experience in another bomb group, 304, and they shipped him down here to put him on a new crew. And the rest of us were like 19, 20, 21 years of age. The co-pilot was a little Irishman from Massachusetts, just a little guy. And but we all got along good. We all worked together.
How GI was it with respect to enlisted men and officers up there in the plane?
In our crew, and there were differences in crews, it depended on your officer. We called our officers Doug, Pat, John. There were some crews that it was sir this and sir that and sir this. I've seen that happen, but we got along real good.
Who was your pilot?
Douglas Mahidi. We were going overseas, and unbeknownst to us, they shipped us from Tampa to Langley Field, Virginia, for radar training. They had come out with that new Pathfinder, and the navigators and the pilots and co-pilot had to get training on these new Pathfinder airplanes. They were using those radars as lead planes when we got to combat. So we spent about 1 month there. From there, we picked up a new airplane and flew into Bangor, Maine on our way overseas. Bangor to Goose Bay, Labrador. Weathered in Labrador. From Labrador, we went to Iceland, Reykjavik, Iceland. The food wasn't too good, so for 3 days, we ate sea rations in the airplane because the food wasn't too good on Iceland.
Did the weather keep you in there?
The weather kept us in there for 2 or 3 days. When we finally took off, we landed in Nuts Corner, Ireland. I can remember the sign, Nuts Corner, Ireland. What we did is delivered a new B-17 to the combat area. We never saw that airplane after that.
So
we delivered it. Yeah.
You didn't get to keep the plane.
No, you didn't get to keep the plane.
And so at some point you got down to Framlingham Base?
From there, they shipped us to assembly point of Stoke-on-the-Trent, and then the gunners were all shipped up to northern England, what they call the Warsh. I don't know whether you heard that. They had a gunnery school up there, and we as gunners got actual training of airplanes flying by, towing a target, and you were shooting your guns over the Warsh, a big area of water. And from there, we were assigned to the 390th Bomb Group at Framlingham.
You were in the tail gun position, correct?
Right, right.
For someone, say, who's never seen a B-17, never been in the tail position or seen a tail gunner, can you kind of give us a description of what that area of the aircraft, describe your work area, so to speak, in there, what you did.
Your work area, you sat on like a bicycle seat. You had your ammunition on both sides of you in boxes. Right behind you was a strut, a big strut, and you wore your heated suit. You had your heated suit. There wasn't a lot of room. But I was supposed to be the ball turret gunner, because the assistant radio man, that's his position. And Doug, our pilot, said Hartman, you're the tail gunner. And so we had a young man from Texas, about 135 pounds. He was a ball turret gunner. The ball was one of the worst positions, because my size, you couldn't even get a chute on to go in there. You had to, if something happened, you had to get out of that area and get your chute on.
You know, back there when at that age, how tall were you back then?
I was 6 foot tall, but I only weighed like 160 pounds. See, 160 pounds.
And in that position as a tail gunner, how was your visibility? I mean, what were you looking at when you were in that position?
You were looking at both right and left. You had a pretty good vision. Confined, but you had pretty good vision.
If you had to get out of there in a hurry, was it possible to do so?
As a tail gunner, I always wore a backpack. A backpack would give you some protection from flak, low velocity flak. And the escape hatch was just behind you. I did have an experience back there. I'm here today because of my pilot.
Tell us about that.
I'm here today. When you go on oxygen, about 12,000 feet approximately. And back in the tail, there's nobody there to see you. And we had oxygen checks run by the navigator. What happened is one time we were going on a mission, and all of a sudden somebody hit me right square in the jaw. I was out, I didn't even know it. And what happened is my foot had come out of my heated boot and my foot was freezing. So I reached down to put my foot back into my heated boot, and this person hit me right in the jaw with his fist, and he said, blankety blank, Hartman, keep this mask on. Then it dawned on me something had happened. When I had put my flak suit on, when we passed over the coast of Holland, I had accidentally disconnected my oxygen. And we were going to, that day, to Munster, Germany. Well, what happened is, this was the pilot back there, unbelievable.
He had come all the way into the back.
He had come all the way back there. And he finally got me in the waist, and I flew that whole way mission in the waist, hearing the flak hitting below, laying there. And the waist gunner took my position in the tail. I always felt bad about that, because being a young man, I thought, what do I do? This man saved my life. But what if I go to the commanding officer and say, you know, my pilot came back in the tail and saved my life? I didn't know what I should have done in hindsight. I should have went to the chaplain, told him my story, and I'm sure he would have gave me a young man sound advice. Because I never had a chance, and this bothered me for years, to tell my pilot, you know, because he was killed later, and so I never had a chance to tell him that. That's just the experience that I had on, that was in October of 10th of 1944.
When did you arrive in England?
We arrived in England in the latter part of July. We went operational. I flew my first mission September the 13th of 1944, the day before my 21st birthday. That's why I remember it. After that, it was a milk run. They say a milk run, but a milk run doesn't mean anything, because something can happen on takeoff or landing. But it was an easy in and easy out. The next mission,
how many missions did you fly?
We were shot down on our 24th mission.
Take us through the missions that you remember or perhaps are memorable in your mind.
My second mission, the roughest targets in that day were synthetic oil, which was Merseburg. And whenever we saw that on the map, we were, our minds, you get a little fear, you know, because it was a long mission. But my second mission was to Merseburg, and I'll never forget it. You go through the flak, and then you see the squadron come behind you, and they're going through the same thing that you just went through, and you say, how are they doing it? Then the most memorable mission that I remember is we had the Polish people in Warsaw were being slaughtered by the Germans in September. So on the 16th of September, we, with orders of President Roosevelt, through connections with the Russians, they finally let us go. We took off for Warsaw, Poland with guns and ammunition. With my second mission, we were tail end Charlie, number 13 in the low squadron, and I was the tail gunner.
You were the last guy.
Last man to go over. So you can see what I mean when I say. We went on the 16th, we got all the way over into Poland, and they recalled us because of bad weather. The 18th, we went. And we went in exceptionally low because they wanted to get the supplies to the partisans if they could. From there, we landed in Russia, stayed there one night. The next day, we flew out and flew a mission to Szolnok, Hungary. There, we got hit, and so we landed at Foggia with one engine on fire. So they let us in right away. Your red flares, and they let us in right away into Foggia. That was our Russian mission, and that's one mission that I remember.
Was there any discussion with an engine on fire as to whether it was safe to stay in the aircraft?
Being in my position in the tail, I'm not really sure. I'm sure Doug, who with his capabilities, would have, if he'd have made the decision, hey, this is it, we got to get out. But he must have looked the situation over. They had extinguishers in there that they could use. In my position, I'm not sure whether they got it completely out. It had a fire in it, so I really can't say definitely on that. I went to Merseburg three times. We were scheduled to go four times, and they stood down, and we all cheered. But on November 30th, we went to Merseburg, and it's a mission that I never will forget because I lost five comrades that day.
Tell us what you remember about that mission.
That mission, we flew, and we had some problems of overrunning the IP, whether it was caused by a tailwind or whatever it was. And the IP is a point where the initial, where you turn in, and this is planned by the group. They try to get you in with the least amount of guns, and they try to get you out as quick as possible. What happened is we overshot that. We ended up going over a town of Zeitz, Germany, and we always kidded about it because they had a bunch of master sergeants there and their aircraft. They were sharp, and we got the living daylights shot out of us over that target. And here we weren't even to Merseburg yet. When we finally turned and got on the target, we were bucking a headwind. Bombing missions were about 160 miles an hour, and we were bucking a headwind. So I was told afterwards that we were in flak for 21 minutes. During that time, I can remember incidents, things happening. I'll never forget. And some of those people were killed that day. But after we got off the target, I said, thank God. And all of a sudden, there was only three of us left. Lieutenant Gary, he must have been a captain, Gary, was in the lead ship with Colonel Dolan.
So there were three planes left
up there. And the number two plane was a crew, Peterson's crew, 407. I remember that because I flew one mission with them. Their tail gunner was hurt, and so I took his position. And so all of a sudden, the tracking flak got us. It was right on us. And here we are, we thought we were out of the flak. And I looked, I turned my head to the right, and I could see the number two ship. The reason I remember it had 407, I flew with them. And while I'm looking at them, the lead ship must have took a hit in the wing because he rolled right over on top of them. And these two airplanes just chewed each other up. Three men in Peterson's crew survived. Two of them are here. Two of them are here. And unbelievable. Colonel Dolan was killed. Maybe you have some stories on this. You know, he was killed there in Merseburg, from what I understand, from the people. We, at that time when they came together, we were in dire straits. The one number two engine was windmailing. It started to windmail over Zeitz. The pilot and co-pilot were so busy they didn't have time to feather it. And of course, when this happened, they had no oil to feather it. So we were down to two engines, and the pilot put it into dive, pulled it up. He had heard that if you did this, the prop might come off under these circumstances. It didn't come off. It didn't come off.
Because if it's windmilling, it's a drag.
It's a drag right there, see. And so we were down to two engines. We were ordered to throw everything out. Then we were down to one engine, just one engine. Finally got the orders to bail out. When I went out, I was on the ground in less than 2 minutes. It was 10-10s cloud cover. You couldn't see the ground.
Was it like to jump out of one of those planes?
It was either do that or go down with the ship. And I know I should have been the first man out, but I must have paused because somebody went out ahead of me and I could see their body tumbling in the clouds. And then I went out. This is one where I have some problems, because the man that landed next to me was a friend of mine. He was the first radio operator. And he was on the bottom of a hill. In between us was a German who was liming the field in the wintertime. There was snow on the field, but he was liming the field. And I thought, what do I do? I'm 120 miles in Germany. There's snow on the ground. Maybe there's strength in numbers. And then I heard a noise behind me. When I had landed, I was very fortunate because I landed in a small tree and I ended up that far from the ground so I could just slip out of my chute. But the engineer came down the hill from behind me. And so we took off and we were loose that night back in the woods trying to keep warm, deciding what to do. And that night, the Germans in this little village, I didn't know it at the time, the Germans were singing all their songs. What I didn't know is the man that landed next to me was taken to that town, and he was killed by a German civilian with a pitchfork. And so all my life, I've said, why me? Why me?
Is there an aspect of, and not just that event, but all those missions you flew, some planes survived, others didn't. Where did fate, your sense of fate fall in all this? You know what I mean?
I look at it this way. You didn't make a lot of friends because you didn't know whether they would be there in the next day. You didn't know. You didn't make a lot of friends. I know that. And you went up over the idea, it's not going to be me. Mm-hmm. I'm going to make it. You had to have that attitude. I think there were some people that got out of flying because of that, had to, because they couldn't do it. They couldn't do it.
This is another strange question, but you know, some guys couldn't do it. Why could you do it? What was in your background, your makeup, your family background? I don't know. Why is it you were able to handle it?
I'm really not sure. I've been brought up in a church family that believes in his faith. I tried not to think about it. You try not to think about it. Otherwise, you wouldn't get your rest, your proper rest in that. Somebody had to do the job. Somebody had to do it. And that's why earlier I said to you in this interview, I said I want to be a gunner. When things like this happened, my mind went back to that. My mind went back to that. We were, like I say, around Kassel, Germany, and we didn't know this had happened. The ball turret gunner was killed right there. His chute never opened. And then we didn't find out till later that the three officers didn't get out of the ship, so they went down. That's how low we were. They went down with the airplane and were killed in action.
What was the name of your plane, by the way?
Ain't Misbehavin' was the name of our plane. The number was 7041. I can remember the number. We walked that night. First we got way back in the woods trying to keep warm. And then we talked it over and just decided that we should try to walk at night. So we were walking at night, heading west, and your mind plays tricks on you. We were a little bit thirsty. We hadn't had anything to eat. And with our escape kits, we had some water purifiers. So we got on top of this hill in the snow, and down below was a little creek with some water. At that time, we went down there, which we shouldn't have done. We went down there, got our escape bags full of water with our pills. And about that time, a German came around the corner and he saw us. So he picked up a club and escorted us to the road. Unbeknownst to me, he was taking us back to the same village where I had lost two comrades. About that time, a German dump truck, it was a dump truck like ours, came by and they took us away from the civilian, and it was full of airplane parts, and they would point at me, and I'm sure it was parts of airplanes that they were told to get certain parts. I do remember one German shared a half of sandwich with me with some food, and it was German brown bread, and it wasn't too good, but I learned to like it for the months later. Yeah. From there they took us to a town of Eswich, Germany, which had a Air Force fighter base there. We stayed in prison that night, and then the next day they put us on a train, took us to Frankfurt, Germany, where they interrogate all the Allied prisoners.
What was the interrogation like? What was the person who asked you the questions, what was he like? What was his techniques, that kind of thing?
Well, I had a bad experience with him, and I was very fortunate because we were told to give our name and serial number, which I did. When I gave my name, George Hartman, he looked at me and he said, soldier, how can you come over here and fight your relatives and kill some of your relatives? And without thinking, I said, sir, I'm sorry, I'm of Dutch descent. And he was immediately mad. And he had me. He could have put me in solitary, and there were guys in solitary there. He could have, but he didn't. He didn't. They knew a lot about us, about our bomb squadrons, everything. They knew a lot about us, but that's all that I said, and that was what he said afterwards.
Where did it go from there then?
We were only there a couple days, and then we went to a town of Wetzlar. They had a camp there, which we got a kit. And that kit included long underwear, pants, different things, probably put together by the Red Cross. It was like a little suitcase that had some cigarettes in it, had some tobacco, had some socks. It had a sweater in there that was knitted. It was a short sleeve sweater that somebody had knitted probably over in England or America, I'm not sure, but a homemade one. I can't think of everything else. It was just something to help us, the little necessities that you would need. From there, that night we were there and the Canadians bombed Wetzlar. Wetzlar had they made cameras there. And I'm sure they were making something in that city for Hitler's war machine, because the Canadians come over, they flared it, and they put a red flare right over our camp where we at to let the Lancasters that were coming in, don't bomb here, because this is a prison camp. I remember that portion.
So they would use different colored flares to identify...
Right, identify the target and right.
Yep. And where not to bomb.
Where not to bomb, right.
So what happened after that then?
From there, this would have been about the 5th or 6th of December in the dead of winter. They put us in a boxcar. We were in this boxcar for 3 days.
How many guys are you together at this point?
A lot. You couldn't hardly move. The guards had one half, and we, as prisoners of war, had the other half, and there was quite a few of us. I can't really tell you the number. On another trip, I can tell you, but this one here, it was crowded. It was very crowded. The problem we had is that night, when we got near Berlin, the British were bombing Berlin, so the guards just left us on the marshaling yards in the boxcar. Fortunate, they weren't bombing that area. But we spent a night in the boxcar in south of Berlin in a marshaling yards. From there, we went to Stalag 4, which is east of Stettin in East Pomerania. The little station was called Kifidi. And when we got there, Colonel Pickard was there with his German Shepherd's dogs, and they marched us to Stalag 4.
What was your impression of the camp? I mean, you got there, give us a description of like, what did it look like? What was the life there like?
The problem there was the Colonel Pickard was, or Captain Pickard, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. He was in charge of all the guards and that. He had one guard, they called him Big Stoop. Now, I don't know whether you've ever heard of this. They called him Big Stoop. He was about 6'5", probably weighed 250 pounds. And he was the enforcer. You didn't dare look at him cross-eyed. He wouldn't think nothing of slamming you in the side of the head. I nicknamed him Ham Hands. His hands were huge. And he has been known to hit a person on the side of the head and even break an eardrum, hit him that hard. And he was in charge of that compound. One time they searched our barracks and they just come in there. Everything that you had was thrown in a pile in the center of the room. If we had some powdered milk, whatever you had, and this man was in charge of that. They were looking for something, maybe a radio. They had heard something, and this is what they would do, room after room after room.
What was the relationship like with the guards? You've described this one man, but did it vary from guard to guard as far as what kind of guys these were?
Most of them were older people. Our guard that was in charge of our barracks, I think we had 10 rooms. The rooms were made for about 16 people, and there was 22 to 24 of us in there with one little stove. And our guard was a little little guy, probably in his late 40s, early 50s. We called him Vasislos. Anybody, we had a guard, watch for Vasislos. And he'd come in, he'd put his hands behind him and walk around, just looking around, looking around.
Did that translate in, if that was German, what did it mean?
Vasislos, I would say, what's cooking? What's happening? What's going on? Vasislos. I'm Dutch descent, and I wish I could have spoke German. I wish I could have, but that's over. It would have helped.
What was the life in actually in your barracks? How was it organized, and did people get along, or how did it work within your barracks itself?
They always had a captain of each room. So it depended on who the captain was. And of course, he had to stay in line or he wouldn't be the captain, or he wouldn't be the captain of that room. But the soup, the food we got was, I call it kohlrabi soup. I call it dehydrated grass soup. And that was dough doled out. You got a bowl of that each day. You got bread, German bread, if the English hadn't bombed Stettin, because every time they would bomb Stettin, the Germans would say they hit the bread factory so you don't get no bread. That was the excuse they used not to give us any bread.
Was there somehow you could scrounge for food in some way?
The only thing we could scrounge for food is they had a potato peel pile there, and us guys would go out there and get gobs of potato peel, put them on top of our little stove, wash them first, put them on top of our stove, and we had potato soup. It tasted like potato soup, and it came out of the potato peels. Yeah, we got red. I was there during the holiday season. They let us out on Christmas Eve, which was unusual. You were locked up like 5 o'clock every night with shutters. Christmas Eve, they let us walk the compound, and they even let the guys put on a Christmas show. I remember that. Christmas show, the guys put it on. We did get a Red Cross parcel at that time, and it was bad because a lot of these fellas had been in there a long time, and that rich food, there was a lot of sick people because of that. They just couldn't keep away from that. They needed to eat it in small portions, so there was a lot of sick people at that time.
Were there British prisoners in this camp?
Yeah, our prison had over 10,000 non-commissioned officers, British and American. Yeah.
Did you ever notice, did the British act differently towards the Germans than, say, the Americans did?
I didn't notice that. They had their separate compound. They weren't right with us. They had their separate compound.
Was escape ever an option?
Escape, where we were at in East Pomerania, it's way up beyond Stettin in the Baltic. No, I don't think so. It was, you were way up there, out of the way, you know, out of the way.
Was there any way in which you were getting news about the status of the war?
We got the news through the British were very sharp on that. They made a crystal radio, and this was broken apart so that, that's what the Germans were searching for a lot of times, the radio. We would get the news from the BBC, and it would be passed around, you know.
How was the news, how was the news disseminated between, around the camp? I mean, was it some guy running around?
You had to be careful, because you didn't know whether you had a stooge. And the Germans were very smart. When we had the Battle of the Bulge, some of the first prisoners from the Battle of the Bulge were put in our camp because they wanted to get our, can you use the term, our dauber down, you might say. Hey, you say you're winning the war? Look at here. These are American. These are prisoners. We just captured them. And they were sharp. And that's my feeling, is that they did that for a reason. They did that for a reason.
Did you feel like you had some idea of what was actually happening in the war because of the radio set and the news coming around?
Some idea, right, yeah.
Was there a point where you were transferred to another camp?
No. When we were there, I got there about, to say, the 10th of December, and we could, in the latter part of January, we could hear the Russian guns in the distance. The Germans had given us one bath. They marched us over to a place, and we didn't know at the time, but after the war, we found out that this is what happened to, they marched these people into a place. It wasn't water, it was gas. Mm-hmm. And I don't remember thinking of that at that time. I didn't think of that, that it could have been. But we did get one shower in the 2 months I was there. And then the Russian guns got closer, and the Germans came in and said, we're going to leave you for the Russians. They'll kill you anyway. Well, about the first of, or the latter part of January, they come in and said, you're going to move. You're going to walk, you're going to ride on a boat, and you're going to ride on a train. This is in the dead of winter, and 1945 was one of the worst winters that Germany had at that time. So I wrote in my notes when I come home that we left on February 2nd. Every book that I've read, and there is one out now, a real good book, two British authors have written this book. It's hard for me to read because it tells about our 86 or 87 day march, living off the land. But I wrote that we left on February 2nd. They said in their book we left on February 6th. I remember we left in a blizzard, in a snowstorm. We had made packs out of shirts, sewed the sleeves to the side, and packed what we had. It wasn't much. I had a pair of long underwear. I had a couple of pair of boxer shorts. I had a couple of pair of socks. I had a pair of gloves. I had had a hat that came in this parcel in Wetzlar, and that sweater, and a GI overcoat. And this is how we started out. And so,
did they give any indication of how long you were supposed to be in transit?
These guards did not know. They did not know. You could see that they didn't know. It was one day at a time for them too. But they at least were able to get decent food. It may have been not real good, but it was decent food compared to what we got. The first march was like, when I look back, about 54 days. In the dead of winter, we slept in barns. When they couldn't find a barn, we slept out in the open. We would pull our, I had a blanket that I had made into a roll. I also buddied with a man by the name of Harold Farrar. I thought he was from Arizona. 2 years ago, I found him. He was in San Diego, California. It took me all those years to find him. And you buddied with somebody to help you do different things, with problems that you had. We never knew how long we were going to walk. We had a kitchen group the first 54 days. It was their job with German personnel to go to a farm and get potatoes or whatever they could get from these farmers. And when we got there, it was usually boiled potatoes or in the boiled potatoes. We ate them out of milk cans, powdered milk cans, came out of Red Cross parcels. I can remember getting in line for potatoes, and you'd get on the end of the line, maybe there'd be some left. I can remember by the time I got to the end of the line, the potatoes that I had were all purple. And I'm saying, ptomaine poisoning, mm-hmm. but they were all purple. But we survived it. I can remember one time we walked around Peenemunde, and they didn't have a place, so we slept out on an open field in the snow. Because we were late, when we got to our farm that we were supposed to go to, they had steamed some potatoes for us. We got in there after dark. The Germans said, you go up and get potatoes. You couldn't see. We had no lights at night in a barn, no lights. I ate those potatoes, and I didn't realize that they were covered with mold. The next day I was real sick with dysentery, and didn't realize it, that happened.
How did you progress then through this march, particularly with your illness then at that point?
What you did is, you never knew how many would be in the group. You might have 300 or 400, you might have 100, just depending whether groups would get together. We live from day to day. Harold and I talked about the food we were going to have when we got home. I can remember one time we got a Red Cross parcel and we shared it. So we made ourselves a candy bar. Now, this candy bar was made out of powdered milk and prunes and German brown bread. We made it in the carton that the prunes came in because it had a wax edge there. So we got this all done, made it at night, and in the morning it had congealed. And I said to Harold, "Now, Harold, this has got to last for a week." I think it lasted 2 to 2.5 days. We couldn't keep from chopping on it. But I can laugh about it now, but it was something we did,
Were you dealing with any of the German population at this point, or were you seeing them, they seeing you?
Oh yeah, they tried to steer us away from the towns, tried to keep us away whenever possible. You slept in barns. The problem we had in barns is the Germans, their drinking fountain was right in the farmyard. And of course, they always told us to boil the water. Well, the first 54, they didn't provide us with water. First 54 days, we didn't have any, couldn't have any fires, so we couldn't boil any water. I just was trying to think of anything else. One town I remember, I had this sweater, and it got covered, it got full of lice. I sat one down one day on the side of a hill, and I picked about 75 lice off of this sweater that didn't even have any sleeves in it. So we got to this German town, and this German civilian, we were bargaining over a fence. This is the closest I got to him. And I think I traded it for 2 eggs and a chunk of bread, my sweater. She wanted that sweater. Well, when I got back, I had a little gob of bread in my stuff, where my stuff was. Somebody had stole it. A fellow American had stole that. That happened once where one of the fellows got caught doing that. And I'll never forget, there was quite a rumpus. The tech sergeant that was in charge of our group took the name and everything, and he says, "You'll be turned in when we get back to the States. You don't steal from a fellow companion who is in the same shape as you are." That's one incident that I remember.
Was there a kind of organization or a hierarchy as you were marching?
Amongst the prisoners?
Yes.
No, not really. The first march we had the kitchen committee, and I'll never forget, I smile about this because there are things happen on this. We're standing in, there's about 500 of us in a barn, and my buddy and I are up in the hayloft. No lights, you're shoulder to shoulder, tempers are short. If you have to go to the restroom, you have to go and holler at the German. And of course, you might step on somebody's head. But anyway, we standing in roll call, and the tech sergeant was standing in front of me, and he said, "I heard there's some complaints about the kitchen committee." "Oh." He said, "I fired them all. Now I'm going to have a new committee." He was standing directly in front of me, and he said, "Soldier, would you like to work in the kitchen?" And I says, "I sure would. Food." So my job, I laugh about this because things happened afterwards. My job was to stoke 2 80-liter boilers. The Germans had given us a half a cow for 500 people. And we had to cook that. We were supposed to stay there for 3 days. I had to stoke these boilers. So when I got over there, I got the fires going, and the first thing I made myself was a can of barley. It was delicious. I can't eat it today. But I made myself a can of barley, and then I had to go. Mother Nature called. I walked out in the barnyard, and there was some people beckoning to me. It was a whole Polish family that were forced labor, and they gave me some sour bean soup. So I knocked that out. Well, then later in the day,
Knocked that out, meaning you ate it quickly.
I ate it. Anyway, later in the day, I had to, nature called again, so I went out there. So I come over there, they had me a slice of German bread with molasses on it. They call it sorghum. It was delicious. Well, about 4 p.m, we were supposed to stay there 3 days. The German Oberfeldwebel come in and he said, "We're leaving in the morning. Cook everything you've got and give it to the men." Well, because I had taken on some food, I had terrible cramps. But I didn't want to lose my job. This is my first day. So gradually I kept getting bent further and further and further. And finally I had to tell the sergeant, "I can't stand up straight." So I said, I have to go back to the barn. So I made myself another can of barley. I didn't eat it. I gave it to my friend Harold. But because of what happened, I had a terrible time with dysentery. I lost my only pair of long underwear. And then I lost my only pants, but I had to wash the pants, so I went up and washed the pants and hung them in the kitchen. The next morning, I stood roll call in my GI coat and boxer shorts. I laugh about it now, but it was a perfect home for the German lice that they had. From then on, I was in misery. And we had two doctors. One was a British. He had no medicine or nothing for us. If you got dysentery, you'd eat some charcoal. He said, "Don't wash your feet, just pat them. Of course, we didn't have any soap or anything. We never had hot water for 80 some days. And we ran out of paper. I was keeping notes, but we had to use the paper. But this is what.
What was the relationship with the guards like in this marching period?
Like I say, they were all older people. I know what I did is I tried to get to the head of the line before we started, because there was always, they're not going to provide transportation for you. So when we started out, I may end up halfway back or three quarters of the way back. But by starting at the head of the line, I didn't have to worry about getting, you know. We walked, and then we took a ride in a ferry boat across Peenemunde Channel there. We did get a boxcar ride of about 60 miles, and then they walked us into, I tell you this because it bothers me, they walked us right by Bergen-Belsen. We didn't know at that time, but thousands of people died there. They walked us to Falling Bostel, to prison camp 11B. It was a camp of all nationalities. And every day, the Germans would take out a cart full of boxes with dead bodies in it. They'd bring the cartons back, so you knew they were just burying the bodies in a mass grave or something. But I found out afterwards, and I read this book, that camp was just a staging point for Bergen-Belsen. The very fortunate thing we were living on at that time, about just 800 to 1,000 calories. But we could hear the American guns and the Canadian guns in the west. So we knew the war should be over.
Liberation was on the horizon?
Liberation. The problem we had before that is they pulled the Americans and the British bombed Dresden. They didn't do this. They did this in March, and it's quite an old, from what I understand, famous city, and they bombed that, and thousands of people were killed. Hitler gave orders, we heard, to kill us all, to kill all the American and British prisoners, flyers. Somebody, we understood afterwards, somebody took offense, didn't take offense. They must have said, no, we can't do that. I heard the term Goering. Goering was the head of the German Air Force. But for me to say it might have been him, but they never, the guards let us know. The guards let us know, hey, orders. But they never did anything. Those were the orders.
Yeah, did you ever get a sense that they would have really followed through with it? Or was it reluctant?
I really just don't think so, because most of them were older people. The problems that we had, the problems you had is the younger people were brought up, and they were, the young men were brought up in the German tradition. And they were anti-aircraft helpers, and you never could tell what these youngsters, 15, 16, 17-year-old youngsters might do, because this was taught to them. They were brought up, you know, during the war, and, you know, so. But the older guards, no. I think they could see the handwriting on the wall that, hey, there was no, you know. We were liberated by the British on May 2nd of 1945. I can remember the British told us the next town we could get some food. We went there.
Let me ask you a question. Did the guards just disappear day?
Or? The guards just disappeared the day before that. The guards just disappeared before that. Hmm. I know when we used to march, they would always count us. Whenever they were short, the Oberfeldwebel would order fixed bayonets, and the guards would go in into the straw and the hay and the barns with their, you know, and a lot of times you'd see a bunch of GIs running out because they could hear the guns. Hey, if we hide for a few days, you know, we hide for a few days. But I don't know whether anybody ever in our group made it or not. Falling Bostel, that was quite an experience, because they put us in a tent. They put us in a tent, head to foot, and then you just would walk there. What we got for a diet there was one can of dehydrated grass, maybe a couple of potatoes, and maybe a slice of bread. That's what we lived on, living in this big tent. I did run into my waist gunner, who would speak German, and he had traded his graduation watch for some bread and I want to say bacon, I forget what it was. And he said, how you doing, George? I said, hey, I'm surviving. And he gave me a chunk of bread and a chunk of his, I think it was bacon, it seems to me. He gave me a chunk of that. He was the waist gunner on our crew. And he was kind of the head of his group because he could speak German. If he'd have been in our group, he would have been the head of our group because he could deal with the Germans. Yeah. Hmm. I remember that.
Well, you were liberated and?
We were liberated. And the first day we went to a German home, and the German home kitchen was full of ex-prisoners sitting in their kitchen. And we said, where's the Germans? They had locked themselves in the fruit cellar. So we got some food. The Canadians had run out of food already, so they didn't have any food. We got something from the Germans. I offhand, it was probably just bread products. The next morning we talked, there was a Polish family there, forced labor. We talked the guy, they had a surrey, a wagon with a horse. We talked to him into taking us to Lunenburg, where we were supposed to meet the British. So we started out in this little Surrey, you know, going down the road. All of a sudden, here comes hundreds of GIs running. The Germans are coming, a whole division. And this Polish man was scared to death. He was scared that if it was true and he did this, the Germans, you know. So he took us back, and what it was, we found out later, it was a whole German division had given up to the British, and they were marching right in order into the town of Lunenburg, because the next day when we got to Lunenburg, they were still marching in there. We crossed a pontoon bridge. The British weighed us. They weighed us, and they shipped us out to a little camp waiting for transportation back wherever they were going to get us. So they took us out in trucks, and they gave us, we each had a little pump. We had, two of us had a pup tent. We never got to use it, because within 5 hours, they came with some trucks, they blew a whistle, and they had room, two airplanes had come in, they had room for so many people, just so many. So we got in line, and I'll never forget, I'm standing in line, and the man next to me just keeled over. Mm-hmm. He just keeled over right flat on his back, and I bent over to help him. While I was doing that, the Germans were counting, and Harold forgot to tell him that I was helping this individual. So when I finally got straightened up, I went to get with this group to get on the airplane. They wouldn't take me. And I said, Harold, how come you didn't tell me? And he felt bad all his life over that. I said, when I found him a couple years ago, I said, Harold, forget it. It was all over. Didn't mean nothing to me, but I, at the time, I thought, why didn't you tell him I was helping somebody? But anyway, the next day, I got out. We got to a camp waiting for transportation. I remember a British bomber came in, and he was swamped. I was over there, and I finally got in the airplane. I don't know how many there was. And the pilot came, and he looked up at me, and I'm looking at him. He says, two of you guys got to get out so I can fly this airplane. And I thought, I've gone this far, I'm not going to take a chance, so I got out. A couple of days later, we got into Brussels. Into Brussels, they deloused us. We got on a train, and the Red Ball Express, which was the truck, GI trucks in European theater, we rode on the Red Ball Express into Le Havre. They put us in camps there. Lucky Strike, 20 grand. They put us in there by states. Uh-huh. State, that's how they, if you were from Michigan, they, certain states were in certain area. And we were there probably about 10 days. And then we got a troop ship, and I think I got home about the 10th of June at that time.
Did your family know that you had been a POW?
My family knew, but something happened here a month ago. You wouldn't believe it. My family was allowed to send me letters, but because I was walking, I never got them. They sent those letters back to my folks, and they were in my mother's cedar chest. And about a month ago, that cedar chest was open, so I got letters that were 60-some years of age. Quite an experience to read. They didn't know, read what mother and dad had, you know. They couldn't say much, but I got those letters about a month and a half ago.
What was the homecoming like with the wife? And?
Oh, wonderful, because when I got home, my wife had been corresponding with the other crew members, and when I got home, the pilot's wife wanted to see me. Navigator's wife, who was her navigator, was not married. His family from Passaic, New Jersey, wanted to talk to me, and they came and they spent a couple days with me, trying to get all the information that had happened. It's hard, because I mean, you survived, and their loved one didn't survive. But in those letters that my mother's chest were two letters from those people thanking me for the information that I gave them at that time. Hmm. At that time.
After the war, just what was your occupation after the war?
My occupation, I went back to SEAL Power, and from SEAL Power, I went into the electrical field. While I was there, they had an advertisement for firemen, and so I took the test for firemen, and I joined the fire department July 12th of 1950, and I spent 29 years in the fire department. I retired in December 23rd of 1979.
You know, at the age you are now, with all the life experience, with all your years, when you look back at that kid that you were that went over to Europe, what do you think about now?
I'm kind of set in my ways, because I've always, people hear me say this, wars settle nothing. Wars settle nothing. And that's the attitude that I have. Wars settle nothing. And it's just too bad. And when we look back on it, we've had wars for hundreds of years. And as an American, I don't know the answer, but that's just my attitude. It settles nothing. It settles nothing.
With that, though, were you proud of your time in service?
It was a calling that we had to do. It was a calling that we had to do. And I'll never forget, a lady approached me on an article she wanted to write on Veterans Day for our newspaper. And unbeknownst to me, I said, I've never done this. And I thought about it, and I said, can I write it? She says, no, you can't. I have to write it. And I'm sure there was a reason for it. But the big message is in there, my message is, lest we forget. Lest we forget. I had five of my comrades that gave their life. They never had a chance to have a family like I did. Four wonderful boys and a wonderful daughter, 10 wonderful grandkids and 12 great-grandkids, and they've all turned out